How did you two pair up for this particular outing?
Grindr.
First time round.
It was kind of a happy accident. I was at a kickoff dinner for something I was doing, and I sat next to the casting directors who were taking care of Hector, and we got chatting, and then they sort of looked at me like, and told me about the film, and that it was Peter, and I knew Peter's work and was a fan, and so I was immediately interested. They set up a dinner. We had dinner. We talked. We got on really well. We sat in his car in the car park, and he showed me this DVD, a film that he'd made. Sounds really weird. Let's get to the end of the story, and it'll sound okay. Of a kind of like sizzle reel of Hector that he'd kind of made, almost like
teaser, yeah.
A teaser that he'd shot of the film to kind of, you know, a mission statement, really. And I saw it and just thought, I'm in, you know, and that was it. And then we never looked back, have we?
No.
So do you think a lot about choices like that? It sounds like it was kind of kismet.
Yeah, of course. I think you have to. I read a lot of scripts when I can be bothered. And it's, you know, you usually know by page five if you like it or not. Maybe sometimes page one. Mm-hmm. Also, the director can be a key factor in your decision to say yes or no. And in this instance, it was both. You know, the script was great and the director was somebody I admired. So that absolutely ticks every box.
But do you think of it in the Simon Pegg experience? Is there a lifetime career move that you're going to make?
No, I don't live. I'm not like that. I don't. Yeah. I just do whatever comes, whatever the wind brings, really. I mean, that's my career all over. I'm like the Forrest Gump of films. No, Forrest Gump is the Forrest Gump of films. I've just found myself, you know, going from where I was to where I am in a quite a sort of haphazard way. So this film, but I did see it as a way of, I want to do more serious stuff. I don't want to just do comedy forever. And I love comedy, but I would like to be allowed to do serious stuff if I want to. And this felt like a nice segue, because it's like, it's a bit of both.
And kind of adult, in a way.
It is adult.
Totally.
I mean, your characters, you're obviously of your age, but it's also, your characters usually have that kind of like youthful energy to them.
Yeah.
And this guy seems like, you know, you start with a very mature person.
Yeah, well, he's someone who's completely forgotten his inner child. You know, my previous characters I've played, particularly like Sean in Shaun of the Dead and Gary King, are sort of like perennial children. You know, they've never grown up and haven't found a way to progress to adulthood, whereas Hector did that probably prematurely and has never been able to reconnect with what he was originally. And that's what he has to learn to do in order to be happy, you know. Because there is a happy medium between being an adult and being a child. It doesn't necessarily mean rejecting everything from your past because it's, you know, frivolous. It's not. There are certain things in childhood which are deeply important. Not least all our emotional parameters, which are set when we're about 7 years old. So, you know, it felt kind of right to do it.
The whole inner child thing is pretty important in the story. Do you know what I mean? I mean, that opening sequence in the plane is like a psychological snapshot, basically. And then the end of the movie, when we first had that dinner, I said, you know, you're in the last scene twice.
Yeah.
He said, what do you mean? I said, I'm going to have you in the trees watching your own wedding, but playing the child Hector. And it's the opposite of the projection when he goes into the booth and he you know, suddenly Clara's marrying her boss and he's the abandoned child, you know, the rejected child. And then at the end.
This is a big spoiler, by the way.
Is it a big spoiler?
People haven't seen it.
I have just ruined it, haven't I?
The whole movie is now.
But
the whole movie is about the journey, right?
The whole movie is about the journey.
You can't spoil it.
But the point is, but the point is that and the thing about casting Simon is Simon has such a natural childlike curiosity. You know, it's a bit. I said to Simon at the time, I'm reaching for a figurative ending. You know, and I cited Peter Sellers walking on water at the end of Being There. I mean, that is the only figurative moment in that film, but it's such a powerful image. I mean, I'm old enough to have sat in the cinema on that opening weekend and heard that universal gasp, you know what I mean? There was a dictum that was going to go in the final image, but it just distilled the film down to one simple thing, and I would rather go with that image. So that, anyway, without spoiling the story, the point is that that relationship with the child within is a big factor in your capacity to be happy or not, I believe. You know, the film's about many things, but it's definitely about that.
So is that what drew you to the material in the first place?
Is that what?
What drew you to the material in the first
place? Oh, you know, it's just, I don't know how else to say this, but my co-writer, Tinker Lindsay, we read it, and it, you know, it's just very us. It's all the things we want to say. I mean, for me, I love to tell a fable rather than a tale, and I love to tell a tale rather than a story. And
what about a yarn?
A yarn is good. A ditty.
I like
would
a ditty.
Be a commercial.
I don't like a
commercial
yarn.
Would be a ditty. Okay. Or a song. But it's like a different. And when I'm writing or co-writing, it's like a different job, and I can get very personal. And I found making this film very liberating. And for those who are old enough to know my early work, it felt like a return to that. He's not old enough. He always says, I remember Peter's work when I was a boy. You know, come on.
I enjoyed Peter's films.
Peter's work when he was a wee lad. You know.
So is your work? Do you see your films as one of for them and one for you, or is it? Are they all personal to you, or are they?
They are. It's just, you know, you got to make a living, you know. And I have to say, I felt that I was drifting before I did this film, and I realized that I had to dig down and get back to what I do best. I think I really don't. I have the capacity to make what I'm doing in the moment, even if it's a commercial for, you know, sanitizer, the most important thing in the world. I mean, I do have that capacity.
It is. There's a lot of bacteria, that's what I'm saying.
So no, but it's like, if I look at an old film like Funny Bones, I look at it and I go, what the fuck was I smoking? I mean, you know, I really do. Yeah, no, I look at it and it's like, seriously. And I look at it and I go, that's insane. But I have a weird imagination, and it's just wonderful to let it run, you know, so it's kind of...
It was cracked, to answer the question.
It was cracked.
Do you ever feel that as an actor when you're in the midst of doing this stuff? I guess in this film, even though it's fanciful, it's not really unreal in any way.
No, I really like, you know, as an actor, you constantly are challenged to sort of reproduce emotions and do what's expected of you as an actor, which is to replicate reality or something like reality. And I really like this film because it exists somewhere between, you know, fantasy and reality, and it some moments were heightened and some moments weren't. And the actual, you know, the important thing was that it's a fable and is heightened in itself, but in the center of it is someone who really isn't Hector. He's the opposite of heightened, you know, and that's a self-inflicted thing. He's like this little sort of repressed thing, unable to feel anything, who's in this incredible world. And eventually it does get to him and he blossoms. But that was really good fun to play.
I think in terms of tone, you know, on that subject, it's like all the actors, up to a point, some more than others, arrived in a slightly too, I'm in a comedy mode. Do you know what I mean? And which is great. But when we did rehearse a lot, and we tried to reset the dials, really. And it was like, and my thing was, look, please play the truth. You know, I don't want absurd characters and absurd situations. Everybody, guys, trust that the fact that the situations are absurd, they're bizarre. Please play the truth. And then in a film, if you want to, I've always had an issue with tonal shift. I like tonal shift.
He's all right.
And tonal shift?
Tony shift.
It's sister Antonia shift. But tonal shift, it's like, in a film like this, life is tonal shift. That's the point. Mm. But if you want to do it in a movie like this, it's what Dickens called streaky bacon. Yes, he did. He did. Meaning, you can do it all in the same novel, film, as long as there's a quality control on all the performances. So you can be ridiculously funny, and thank God for Simon, because, you know, Unbreakable drops the plate. It's just pure Laurel and Hardy. I don't know many people. Simon has funny bones. He's also a fearless actor. There's a gift to someone like me. So once I'd set all those dials, and Simon saw the picture and said, thank you for what? You said, you know me, you never knowingly underplayed. Which is fine.
He kept a rein on me.
I gotta finish this. Because, no, it's not that I kept a rein on you. It's like, once we get in the right place, I used to sit there and say, Simon, I have a note. It's this, more Simon. Because he's so inventive, and he's, I hate to use it because it sounds like an all-purpose device, but he is extremely charming and warm on film, but incredibly precise. So it's a joy for me to not direct, if that makes sense. You know, it's kind of.
I just recalled, interestingly.
You can talk about my shirt.
Oh, well, it's nice. I remember the first thing that we did, one of the first things we did when the first day we rehearsed, was that Peter got me to read a sonnet by Shakespeare as truthfully as I possibly could. And it was a little exercise that we did that was like, you know, it was like being back at drama school. It was like, read this and mean it. Because you can read Shakespeare and it can be a lilty, sing-song kind of beautiful collection of words that you're not sure exactly what it means, but it sounds really clever and must be good because it's dense and well written, but it was like, read this and mean it, and we did it a couple of times. Well, more than that, and I took it home and I really started to study the words, and that was a real key to a lot.
It's like a body scan. It's like, it's literally like a body scan.
They should do the TSA should do it.
So what are you here for? We're going to give you a sonnet.
That's right.
Sincerity is very hard to come by these days.
It's particularly with the TSA. I didn't mean it. Please, going
to
come back to
it. But it is. It's like a. Because I said to Simon, you need to know what it's like being directed by me, and I need to know what it's like directing you. And it's like we did, yes, a bit of Shakespeare and everything, but it's like a body scan. I go, oh, that's interesting. Oh, I know I can help that bit, and that's amazing, and whatever. And it's just
like you did a reading of me.
I did a reading.
You did.
Like the Intuit. Yeah. The Intuit.
Read this sonnet.
Intuit.
The Inuit.
The clairvoyant.
Like an Eskimo.
What is it?
Intuit, I think, is a brand of tax software.
That's right.
Inuits are this.
I'm an intuitive. No, the intuitive. Yeah. See.
I wanted to be a psychic, but I wasn't into it. I just thought of that.
You did.
Yeah. That's pretty good.
That's pretty
good.
Write
that down. Nobody does.
So is there another performance on camera somewhere? Is there footage on the ground that would? I mean, did a lot of it change in post, or did you find it on set?
It's my Cockney performance. Every now and again, because Peter wanted Hex to be very fastidious, and occasionally I get a bit London, because I am a bit London. I lived there for 20 years, so if I sounded a bit like it, and I might, as it going, people go, less Cockney, less Cockney. Less Cockney.
I didn't say less Cockney, I said less London.
Yeah, you go, you're less London, less London, which I really appreciated. I like being directed as an actor.
He is very, very directable.
I don't like not knowing what is wanted of me, you know. It's good to be told. The director shouldn't be coy about that with actors. I think the trouble is actors sometimes like, who the fuck do you think you are telling me what to do? Well, he's the director, that's his job or her job. So I'm happy to kind of like to be told. Some directors are a bit coy because they're worried the actor's going to throw a hissy fit and go off to their trailer. Some of them do.
Doesn't seem like you hired that group of actors in this picture though.
It really, really was
Rosamund's
good.
Rosamund's a little tricky.
No, she's not. It was really good.
So, but I mean, did you know when you were shooting? Did you get exactly what you wanted when you got to post? Did you kind of know what the film was going to feel like, and or did you adjust in post?
No, it's weird, Dave. When I'm involved in the writing, and what I loved about our DP Collier is he would quote the script and he'd come on the set and he'd quote the script, the stage directions, as it were, not the dialogue. Because when you write a script, you know, I hate it when directors do scripts and it's full of directorial, like close up on, tracking with, and everything. It's nonsense. Mm-hmm. You've got to write a script more like a novel that is to be interpreted by a bunch of people who will then give their version of it. Do you know what I mean? It's more collaborative that way. Do you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I've lost my train of thought, but the point is what the film's like. No, it's interesting, because I had to pick up the script again the other day, so I was asked for the final grade, and I'm looking at the script and I go, that's the film. And if someone, and what was nice about Collier, he would say, do you want to be here because, and he'd quote the script. And I was so impressed because it made him interpret it. So in answer to your question, no, the film was exactly what I was really very close to the script and more. You find things in post, like I took the animation further, you know, there were certain devices, but no, it really is, it's pretty close to the script. It's why I like writing, you know, or co-writing, it's the same thing, you know.
Interesting story. We used to, Collier, who was our DP, we used to call him Koala, because it's okay to be racist about white Europeans.
So, some of the film feels improvisatory, particularly in groups. A lot of the moments feel like there's just a moment happening, particularly when there's the cooking sequence and the whole family is there and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
Was it that? Was that part of the...
Well, the
South Africans...
They're the best.
They were just so spirited and natural. People who'd never acted before.
The South African supporting artists generally would constantly surprise us. Like the woman who plays the mother when we're operating on the kid who's got shrapnel in his leg and his mum's going crazy. We got someone, we said, can you come over and be a mum just a sec? Just be a bit upset. This is called action, and she just suddenly started doing this amazing performance. And we were like, what? What? Hang on, just can't fire her. You know, she's upstage with me and Barry. But there was a real sort of, I don't know whether it's a social thing, but they were just more in touch with, they were just easier with it, you know, with sort of just participating. You get some supporting artists who were happier. Just like scenery. They were happier.
Frankly, more smiles in the townships than Beverly Hills.
And how many places were you to shoot the film?
It's all in the green screen.
Oh no!
You have no idea. Los Angeles, Vancouver, London, Johannesburg, outside Johannesburg, Shanghai, mountains of China, Bavaria, Austria, Nepal,
Tibet, as well. And you
that's, that, that's what I meant by mountains of China.
Politically,
Jews. Listening is loving, Simon.
He wants to go to get into China, is what it is. There's a lot of money there to make movies. So you run everywhere. You did not fake it.
No, it would kill me. It killed me, you know. But it was worth it. I mean, and here's the thing. We had so many setbacks, and I hate to say this because it means you're always worried someone's going to go, oh, so we can be sloppy.
Yeah.
But with every setback, it turned out for the better. We fell upwards again and again and again.
Yeah.
I find that when I'm contriving a sequence, and there's a lot of in-camera trickery, but most of it's in camera. The CGI stuff is, I hope you agree, imperceptible, which is what it should be. I think CGI should not replace what you don't have. It should augment what you do have.
Mm-hmm.
So they're like, they call it handoff and all that, which is like hand job, but for people that work in the film. No,
hey.
But what
hand
I mean
is. Hand job
is
hand job, buddy.
But seriously, it's like, whenever I was contriving stuff, like when he gets to the monastery, without spoiling it for the viewers, there's a sequence where I go, you know, within the space of 50 seconds, I go, Vancouver, Nepal, Tibet, Austria, Vancouver, Vancouver. But, you know, that's how it comes together. So with the difficulties, I just tend to get more inventive because I cannot bear negativity on the set. You know
necessity
what I mean?
So is the mother of invention.
Oh, yeah, you know, I knew you were going to say
well,
that.
I think it's
and I was going to give you a note early and say, you have to do better. You have to do better than that.
I think it's a saying that really rings, it's a maxim that really rings true for the film industry in that when you're forced to solve problems on the go, often you will come to a compromise which is better than the original solution because you're forced to think. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, sometimes it's good not to have everything handed to you on a plate. Sometimes films that have masses of money just end up like messes because everybody got what they wanted. Whereas
it's a balance.
We were kind of like scuppered a couple of times. There was a half a yak in the road once in Tibet, remember that? That was disgusting. Got hit by a car and there was a half. Don't laugh, who's laughing at a half yak? You choose that to laugh at, audience? There's nobody here.
So, I mean, you've done a lot of time in front of green screens in your years. Is it different to go to these places and to have this kind of you on the journey as well? Or
it makes an enormous difference because alongside what you're seeing on narratively in the film is a parallel journey for us personally.
That's
when
right.
We're in those places. And there is a degree, even if it's only a buried kind of fragment of wonder at being in an African game park or being near a lion, as close as a lion I was. I was genuinely, that was the first time I'd ever been within eating distance of a lion. And so it was kind of, you know, it's great to have that because it helps you as an actor. When you're in front of a green screen, you have to pull it out of nowhere. You have to, however good you are, and we've seen it before because we've seen brilliant actors do films in front of green screens and not be brilliant.
Mm.
But if you're helped by good physicality around you, it just lifts everything.
I'm a big reality freak.
Oh, Kardashians is never off your TV.
God almighty. In terms of especially for the actors, giving them everything to make the scene feel, you know, all the Skype calls, the other person is on a live Skype in the other room, you know, it's like all the screens and which would normally
Rosamund's were for me.
I would then give you a good enough voice, you know, or an actress.
And I had
an actress playing Rosamund.
Yeah,
and then I would, you know, do my Rosamund Pike. No, but you know what I mean?
It's like, for us now?
No, I can't do that.
You should never do Rosamund Pike on camera.
But it's like, it is. I'm a big reality freak, you know. Although I have like two sides. I'm a techno geeky person and photographer, but at the same time, you have to really just create a reality because it just things bubble out the ground. You know, it's just better.
Interesting point regarding the Skype calls because the way we had to do it, we couldn't when we were away and Rosamund had basically finished up her stuff. We couldn't call her at 3 a.m. and say, "We're going to do the Skype call now. Get up."
Which she, by the way, was prepared to do.
Yeah, she did. I say she'd do it.
No, so I really want to be there for Simon.
I know. She's
that was my Rosamund.
There you go. It was good.
It was good, wasn't it?
She. We did all her calls with me in another room, so it was all. And one of the calls, something I won't say what happens, just because. Anyway, something happened that was really unexpected, and she just went with it and kept going with it.
Fantastic.
So when we came to do my half of it, I. found a way to interact with that moment like it had just happened. And so the whole thing seems incredibly real, when in actual fact...
You can tell what that moment
was. She knocked a cup over. She went, oh, what have you done? Kind of, did you do this?
She said, oh, look, the cup's falling. This is what you do, you see.
And I'm on there and go, no, I didn't know it. It just really worked.
And I said, cup, that's the best line in the screenplay, and you wrote it, Rosamund. You know? But it is. You just set the parameters in which the actors can feel very, very secure and play. You know, that's...
But I had I had every one of Rosamund's Skype chats on a file in my computer, and I watched them over and over again before I did the scene.
Your version.
And then
the
one of her when she's in the bathroom in her underwear, I watched that over and over again before I went to bed.
That's a whole nother movie. So were you guys thrilled when you saw what Walter Mitty would be in last Christmas?
Thrilled by what?
I don't. There seems to be some proximity to your film.
Oh, when I watched it as a screener for BAFTA, and I watched Walter Mitty, and I started to get a little sweaty, and I felt like, oh, this is similar. You know, we're crossing similar grounds here. And I phoned Peter and went, And he went, it's fine. It's like, you know, it can coexist.
It's fine. Honestly, it's not. When if you see the two films, you know that they're different enough. They really are. You know.
Well, for me, my experience of your movie was that I was kind of like, I kind of wish that Bennett had less money, which is kind of like the conversation we were having earlier, that you guys did it in a much more similar tale, his take on Walter Mitty at least, and that you did it in a much more emotionally driven way than a physically driven way, and the giant visuals and everything that were in that movie, that some of which were great, but you guys hit the heart, pounded on that over and over again instead of the look.
Yeah, I think the focus
Thank you. Yeah. If you can't afford the exterior of a Boeing going across the Atlantic or whatever, draw it. You know, I mean, a lot of the, draw it and animate it. And the African plane, you know, is that model. You see the watering can come in at one point doing the rain. You know, I mean, I decided to just embrace what we didn't have and turn it into the elements that make up a fable and keep it childlike, because that's Hector's mentality. Does that make sense? And then we made him a good doodler and a good drawer. Then the drawings animate or whatever. And people seem to be very taken with that. They like it, and it does the opposite of alienating them. What was it the Germans called it? Verfremdungseffekt. Like the Brechtian thing, you know, that you have deliberate devices that alienate the audience. We're getting very pretentious now.
Arctic chill.
But it's true. Do you know what I mean? The audience actually enjoy the... It's the playful
showing
element.
That you're showing. That's the thing. It's that thing.
Just occasionally. And then you go back to a very, very concentrated reality. But you can do the two. You know?
I think there's something to be said for artificiality in film. We've got very, very sort of obsessed with making everything super, super real. When in actual fact, if you're watching a horror movie and it cuts to a fake head, you know it's going to explode in a minute. So you get a bit excited. And there's a sort of like... There's a result of the artificiality and your relationship to it, which adds to the enjoyment of the movie. It's okay if you don't. I don't sit and watch Transformers and think, oh, where did they get those robots? It's amazing. I think no, somebody even.
Or if you see, the skyline of 16th century London, nobody goes, oh, they went back in time. You know, they just go, that's brilliant CGI. Mm-hmm. So in my eyes, you're already out of it in a way. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So it's like you. I love CGI, and it's made me direct differently. It's made me write differently because you know what you can do, and it's more
an effective tool.
It's brilliant.
I think it's like synthesizers. This is my theory.
Yes.
My theory.
Go ahead, buddy.
Back in the 80s, when synthesizers first appeared, everyone was like, "That's it. No more drums. Guitars are dead. This is it. Everyone's going to play the synths, and that's it." And for a while, it was just all synth music, and then eventually, it took its part in the pantheon of instruments, and now it's a beautiful part of film music making. CGI was like that. Everyone was like, we can do this now. Giant spiders can do this, and great. And now eventually it's settling down into something which is a really brilliant, incredibly valuable tool, and it's not too big for its boots anymore.
Most of the time people don't even know what's happening.
That's the
they shouldn't, you know, that's the thing. I see terrible CGI in really prominent films. I think it's terrible because I suppose I'm looking at it with the director's eye, but...
Which one is it? I thought it was that.
But it's like, you know, the opening in the plane. Mm-hmm. Well, was Simon Pegg really flying that plane with a dog as a...
Why do you think the dog fell out? I was flying it.
There's nothing funnier than a dog. It's dead.
I always find that funny.
Do you know, it's always a turning point. No, we sit in screenings. You sit in screenings. It's because I'm British and my wife always says, Peter, they're not going to get your jokes. My wife's from Boston. And we sit in the screening room and we test the film here in the ArcLight show at Oaks. You know, what happened with the film was Relativity saw it. Mm-hmm. My very, very dear old friend, she's young actually, but Robbie Brenner. And she saw the film and said, oh, love it. Don't know what the audience is, you know, whatever. And I said, Robbie, test it. I promise you, I've tested it. Something happens in front mm-hmm. of an audience. You know, it's extraordinary. So we 300 people at the Sherman Oaks. She said, what kind of people? I said, normal people, you know. So I go in and it's looking a bit too normal for me. I'm going, I got very worried, but I won't give you the number, but it scored through the roof. It was an amazing night. And then I did some more work on the film after that. But that moment in the first scene where I'm giving the story away, but the dog does what we just said it did, which people would have forgotten about. That's like the litmus. It goes, okay, we're off. They're going to like this. And then those kick in. And I thought, OMG, this is why I moved to America. They don't like me. No, I don't mean that. Also, so I just mean it. I just mean it was like, it was just funny. What?
Also, you moved here so you can say OMG without being embarrassed as well.
I know, I've got to get better at that.
Do they have different things like that in England than we
do
in the US?
No, we're just ashamed of ourselves.
OFG.
But do you have different like little Twitter acronyms and things that we don't
yes,
use
Yes, it's all things like hashtageth and...
well, I'm actually,
you didst not do that.
I'm actually thrilled for you guys that you're going to Toronto because I think that it's an audience movie.
Yeah.
You know, it's a small movie, but it's a movie that you don't... It's hard to find the right audience, but in Toronto... They fall in love with movies like this, and you know it should be a nice place for you guys to play.
I hope so.
I'm
My
excited.
First movie went to a big screening in Toronto, and that, mm-hmm. That was when I went, okay, maybe I should move to America. No, I'm only half joking, but it was like, it was very nice for me to be accepted. Do you know what I mean? Because and the other thing is I've directed American stories, and I get very paranoid about not being authoritative, mm-hmm. you know. And I have a co-writer who takes care of women and America. Do you know what I mean? She's an American woman, uh-huh. because I get very paranoid when I don't.
Two big things.
What?
Women and America. Woman and America.
So you know what I mean? I've had bad ones. I've had, you know, it's been bad.
So is this the beginning of a different era for Simon Pegg? Do we think?
It's definitely the end of my career. No, I hope so. I'd like to. Yeah, absolutely. I just want to do. The most important thing for me is to enjoy the process of filmmaking. If you can get to the end of that and have a product that you're happy with and people go see it, brilliant, because it means you can do it again. But the most important thing for me is to enjoy making the film, which is what most cinema goers never see, really. They never. You know, and they hear people going about, oh, it was great, and these people were lovely. But personally, for me, I have to enjoy my day to day job, which is, you know, being an actor.
But that bleeds through.
Yeah, and yeah, it can add to the...
The spirit of a shoot, you know, sometimes I feel like I'm wearing a white coat because it's just my job to make... It's like being the host to a very, very, very long-running cocktail party. Mm-hmm. Are you all right? Everyone all right? You know, want another drink? It's fine. You know, it's like you're just keeping everyone happy. But it is important, as well as everything else you're doing, to get... And Simon, you know, there's a dictum in the film, does this person bring you predominantly A up or B down? Well, guess what? This guy brings us all up every single day, and it's a fantastic element and addition, other than being a fearless actor, you know. So the question was, is this a new era in the life of Simon Pegg? The weirdest thing is I love comedians. You know, I made a film about comedy once, and I see, in a good comedian, I see the brilliant actor that gets to that laugh, that gets to that funny moment, and the really good comedians, especially when they're physical, to me, it's an acting instinct. It's just one and the same. And I would go so far as to say, I don't know if I've ever called an actor a brilliant actor if he or she couldn't do comedy. Mm. That's a big, I'm gonna get in a lot of trouble for that. Big trouble. But you know what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
It does. I just want to win a golden dildo.
And you consider yourself the inverse? Are you an actor first or a comedian first, do you think?
I don't... I always kind of see them not as not being mutually exclusive. I kind of think if you're an actor, then you do it all, you know, and you can specialize in comedy. If comedy is something that you particularly enjoy or you're particularly good at, then that maybe that's something that you kind of like concentrate on more. Mm. But particularly with films like this, very much this film, but also with the films like Shaun of the Dead and The World's End and on Hot Fuzz, which are overtly slightly more comic than Hector, there's still moments in that where we have what I call misery relief, which is when, you know, things get serious for real. You know, when Sean has to shoot his mother, or you find out that Gary King is a suicidal alcoholic, it's like, that's not played for laughs. And for that to work, you have to play it properly. So I consider myself an actor. I was a comedian. That's when I stood on stage with a microphone. But I'm an actor now.
Yes.
So Yabu sucks to you, comedians. No, not really. I miss you.
And the next Hector will be in motion capture, I assume.
Oh, yeah.
Go the whole monkey nine style. Yards.